Stravinsky. The orchestra comes together for the first time to play an afternoon of old and new music. This event is free, and for more information, visit WashingtonHeightsOrchestra.org. On Tuesday, October 27th, from 12 to 2 p.m. at the Rendell Memorial Presbyterian Church, the Harlem Afternoon Jazz Series presents Graham Haines and Synesthesia. Musical innovator and extraordinary composer Haines is an emerging force in contemporary electronic music and world music. For ticket information, visit WelcomeToHarlem.com. Also on Tuesday, October 27th at 6 p.m. at the City College of New York, the Black Studies Lecture Series presents Graham Hodges, The Underground Railroad in New York. Graham Hodges will discuss best-known conductor of the Underground Railroad, David Ruggles, and respond to questions from the audience. This event is free, and for more information, visit facebook.com/blackstudiesccny. On Wednesday, October 28th at 6 p.m. at Mist Harlem at 40 West 116th Street, NBA superstar Kareem Abdul-Jabbar will be signing and discussing his brand new novel, Mycroft Holmes. This event is free, and for more information, visit mistharlem.com. If you have an event that you would like to place on our calendar, please call 212-650-7481 or email communitycalendar@whcr.org. Submissions must be made 3 to 4 weeks prior to the event. This is Huma Saida for WHCR 90.3 FM, the voice of Harlem.
Harlem has its own radio station.
For you and yours,
WHCR 90.3 FM.
The livest party in the whole universe.
The voice of Harlem.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Harlem Beat, a community's affairs show produced by the radio journalism class at the City College of New York. I'm Katiuska Nunez, your host for the evening. You can listen to or watch this broadcast live at WHCR.org. On today's show, reporters Paloma Torres, Danielle Sattar, and Yvette Andino will tell us about the nation's most wildly creative public participatory event in NYC for Halloween. Also, for our feature story, reporters Sally Abreu and Michael Sanchez will talk to a professor who taught a course on horror here at City College. But first, the headlines. In international news, a powerful earthquake hit a remote Afghan northeast district on Monday. The earthquake was measured at a magnitude of 7.5 and killed more than 200 people in Afghanistan, according to Huffington Post. Residents of Pakistan were also affected, where hundreds have been injured. Officials say the death toll could climb in the coming days since communications were down the Hindu Kush mountain, which was the center of the earthquake. In national news, the South Carolina sheriff deputy that was filmed dragging a Spring Valley High School student out of her desk has been fired. Richland County Sheriff Leon Law announced the news Wednesday, adding, "Deputy Ben Fields did wrong Monday." The state's attorney office and the federal probe to determine if Fields violated the civil rights of the 16-year-old black female. In local news, according to DNAinfo.com, Kudeja Diawara, a 55-year-old immigrant from Mali, was convicted of running an apartment scam on other African immigrants. Diawara collected more than $22,000 from her victims who were looking for cheap apartments in Harlem. She was able to lure them because she had a reputation for being able to find cheap apartments, but now many are now homeless, some living in shelters. 10 of them faced her in court and testified to giving her up to $5,000 each for an apartment, never to hear from her again. Manhattan Supreme Court Justice Thomas Farber sentenced Diawara to up to 7 years in state prison. I'm Yvette Andino for WHCR 90.3 FM New York. Back to you, Kat. Looking for something to do after you take the kids trick-or-treating this Saturday? Paloma, Yvette, and Danielle have more.
Halloween is right around the corner, and lots of people will be coming to the Village Parade right here in New York City. Since Halloween is supposed to be for kids, we wonder why 100,000 adults march in the parade and another 2 million people watch. So my classmate, Yvette Andino, contacted the parade's director, Jean Fleming, to find out why. And it turns out it's not for the reasons you think.
You know, the world seems to be so fraught these days with conflict and division. We felt that what had to happen was that we would shine a light into the darkness. That's what the parade is, when you work with your imagination and creativity and you bring communities together. In a certain sense, you're shining a light in the darkness. You're saying that, yes, we can come together and not be separate. We can understand each other. It's so much easier to understand someone if you've actually, you know, walked beside them for a while or seen how they do something.
In spite of all the unity among the living, it's the floating dead who start the parade, the skeletons. Made of ivory-white bones held up by puppeteer sticks, Fleming says they are not there to scare us.
The reason why they leave the parade is because the skeletons, having just lost life, know the value of life. And so they come back on Halloween and they dance to remind all of us that while you're alive, you should dance.
Oriana, a senior at City College who majors in English, has been to the parade several times.
There's so many people participating. It makes you feel like you're part of something big. People dressed as giants, and they're just walking on sticks. They look like huge skeletons. I think there was someone dressed as a huge banana just running around everywhere, and there was a gorilla chasing it. This woman dressed up as the Mona Lisa, and she had the drapes and everything and the painted on smile, and she had this huge picture frame around her, and she was being interviewed by the news. Suddenly, this guy that I'm assuming they were there together, he was dressed as a robber, just sneaks on into view, and he like grabs the frame and he like steals her away. And it was so creative, and like, I'm like, I don't know what I'm gonna see this year. And if you don't go this year, who knows what you're missing, because it's not gonna happen again.
But my other classmate, Danielle Sitar, talked to her father, and he shares some unpleasant experiences surrounding the parade.
Hi, Dad. Please introduce yourself.
My name is Patrick Sitar. My age is 65 years old. I grew up a Cap for 24 years. And my experience is that it's very dangerous to drive a cab on Halloween Day, because a lot of my cab driver friends got robbed. And a lot of the people is be on drugs and alcohol. So it's a very scary day to be out there working. But a lot of people go to have fun too. But still, you know, it's very scary.
So, do you have a specific experience that was scary during the time of the parade with any specific situation with a passenger?
Not me personally, because I don't work, but I got friends.
Right.
I had experience. I got friends got robbed, friends got into arguments, you know, with a lot of crazy people out there. So, I don't like working Halloween. I stay home.
Yeah. I know you mentioned to me, Dad, that during Halloween time, the taxi drivers are a little afraid to work because people wear costumes and rob them. So your friends have experienced that during the time of the Halloween parade in the city? Is that what you're saying?
That's right. I would say most of the people is nice people, good people. It's a handful of bad people that do these things. You know, it's a handful of people like anything else. You know, it's a handful of people is do evil things and bad things, you know.
Yeah, I agree, Dad. Well, thanks, Dad. I mean, you're giving us some really useful information about what happens during the parade. It's not always fun and Halloween and costumes. There's a dangerous side, too.
Right.
Well, thank you for your time, Dad, and you have a good night.
Okay, thank you, too.
Although there is clearly a dangerous side to the village parade, still millions gather to march and watch. There are also precautions you could take to stay safe. Never travel alone at night. Be aware of your surroundings. And don't wander off with people you don't know. The Village Parade will be held on Halloween Day, Saturday, October 31st, starting at 7 p.m. If you would like to participate in the parade, go to halloween-nyc.com. I'm Paloma Torres, Yvette Andino, and Danielle Sotar are our reporters for WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
If you like scary movies, books, and TV shows, listen up. Reporters Sally and Michael will pick the brain of a professor who's very well known for his love of horror.
Hello, everyone. I'm Sally.
And I'm Mike.
And welcome to our Halloween Horror Special.
On the phone with us this evening to talk about all things horror is Professor Andrew Shepherd. Professor Shepherd is a PhD candidate at Stanford University. Last year, he taught a special English course here at CCNY called Horror in Short Fiction. He's working on his PhD in English and has a love for sci-fi, fantasy, and most importantly, horror.
Professor Shepherd, welcome to Harlem Beat.
Hi, thanks.
How are you doing this evening?
I'm doing pretty well. How are you?
We're doing pretty well, too. So tell us about your time here at City College. What was your experience like teaching the horror class?
And was I a good student, Professor?
You're a terrific student, Mike.
Thank you.
I remember your paper quite well. You wrote about, a video game in relation to, it was The Horla by Guy de Maupassant.
Right.
It was a really cool paper.
Right, The Horla and The Amnesia, The Dark Descent. I remember that. It was a very fun paper.
Right. Okay. Yeah, it's fun to read. As far as my experience teaching a horror class at CCNY, it was a lot of fun. It was a really sort of positive, interesting experience. I got to talk about one of my favorite subjects and some of my favorite stories, and I got to introduce them a lot of sort of awesome sort of horror tales to people who hadn't encountered them before, and that was pretty cool. It was just really sort of neat. One of the sort of exciting things was going over, say, New York, specifically New York horror tales, like Washington Irving's The Legend of Sleepy Hollow, or Clive Barker's Midnight E-Train, or The Diamond Lens by Fitz James O'Brien, with actual New Yorkers, and discussing how your relationship to the city affects how you read those tales. That was an interesting experience, especially it being my first time in New York. So.
Yeah, I remember that, the Sleepy Hollow. I think that was our first story we covered in class. So, Professor, yeah. I wanted to ask you, what do you believe draws people to the horror genre?
I think it's really cathartic. It's funny because being in fear of one's life is normally not considered a pleasant or pleasurable sensation, but there is something pleasurable about encountering that type of, or engaging with that type of, that sort of negative affect in a controlled setting, like watching on a screen or reading it in your room, reading horror fiction in your room on a rainy night.
Mm-hmm.
We're naturally sort of, afraid of dying. And so it's pleasant to sort of get that out of your system and confront those fears in a way that doesn't actually put you at risk.
Okay. So.
Sounds reasonable. So being a horror enthusiast, you must know about the new season of Ryan Murphy's American Horror Story. What is your take on the series?
I have not seen Hotel yet, but in general, I'm a fan of American Horror Story. I think it's great that Ryan Murphy has sort of brought anthology horror back. He sort of solved an interesting problem with staging horror on television, actually, which is that basically television tends to favor serialized narratives. The problem with serialized narratives for horror fiction is that if an actor or an actress has been signed essentially a series regular, there's very little chance of that person dying, or at least dying and staying dead.
Mm-hmm.
And so basically, you tend to worry less about what could happen to that character. And so basically the idea of doing a different story each season sort of alleviates that problem. But I like the idea that he has his sort of own repertory company that shows up and plays different types of characters each season.
Mm-hmm.
I like the idea of setting it in different cities and sort of blurring the lines between, fictional horror and real-life American horror stories. in season one, they tie in the Black Dahlia murder, which is one of the famous unsolved murder mysteries of Los Angeles. Season three ties in and Marie Laveau, who are both real-life historical figures from New Orleans. So there's this sort of interesting engagement with actual American folklore and sort of the macabre history of our country. That's kind of cool.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So besides American Horror Story, do you watch any other scary TV shows?
Yeah, quite a few. I keep up with Supernatural pretty regularly.
Yes.
My cousins love that.
I kind of lost interest, but okay.
There's a period in the middle of the run, around season 6 and 7, where it goes into a lull. It sort of picks up again. Right now, it's still pretty fun.
Yeah.
Just got through watching Hemlock Grove season 3, which the ending was kind of a letdown, but it was still a fun ride. I've been watching lately. There's quite a bit of stuff to I haven't seen Scream Queens yet, which I've heard good things about. So
it's more comedy.
So
I'm
excited to check that out.
Not exactly a fan.
We've got the Ash versus the Evil Dead, the Sam Raimi's big follow up to the Evil Dead trilogy is going to be a TV show, and that starts on Saturday.
Wow.
So I'm very excited about that because I'm a huge fan of those movies. So, speaking of horror comedy, if you're a fan of the genre and you're a fan of Bruce Campbell, you probably know this already. But that one's pretty exciting.
Cool. I just also wanted to ask you, what's your favorite horror film, and who do you consider your favorite horror director?
That's tough. Favorite horror film. Can I cheat and make it a tie?
Sure.
Okay. I'm going to say Rosemary's Baby by Roman Polanski.
Okay. That was terrible.
And the original Nightmare on Elm Street.
Yes.
Rosemary's Baby did give me nightmares as a child. That was fun. And what about your favorite director?
Favorite director?
Mm-hmm.
Probably Craven. Wes Craven's done a lot of terrific stuff in the genre.
Absolutely.
Okay, and Professor, are there any upcoming horror films that you're looking forward to?
Oh, let's see. Upcoming horror films. There's one that's coming out called The Witch, which looks great, and it's set in colonial New England. I would say among the Puritans. So that looks interesting. I'm interested in that type of old school American Gothic in the Hawthorne vein. Let's see. There's a few exciting things on the horizon from what I've seen. There's a horror western coming out with Kurt Russell and Patrick Wilson called Bone Tomahawk.
Bone Tomahawk?
Bone Tomahawk. Yeah, that one looks cool. Just came out, I think, last week. So I'm probably going to check that out soon.
Might as well check it out, too. I was also going to ask about, I'm not sure if you heard of it, Crimson Peak by Guillermo del Toro?
Oh, yes.
I'm a huge Del Toro fan. I am planning to go see that Saturday, actually.
Oh, wow.
Looking forward to it.
Are you watching this TV show, The Strain?
I have not seen The Strain. I love vampires, though. So,
is
like,
that what
I
they
mean,
are?
Part of it
they
is
were
like.
Aliens. I thought they were aliens. Okay, they're vampires. Okay.
I think they might be vampire aliens, which there is precedent for.
That would be amazing.
I stopped watching it because it was too freaky for me.
Yeah.
I wasn't sure what
that's
watching.
An endorsement.
I wasn't sure what I was watching, so I just stopped.
That's what happens when you deal with vampire aliens. So, Professor, I just wanted to move on and ask, what do you think the worst things about horror films are? Like, the most overused trends or cliches?
Overused trends and cliches. I think Cabin in the Woods kind of nailed a lot of them. I love that movie precisely because it's such a clever intervention into the horror genre, and like potential pitfalls and cliches with it. I think we're sort of like, so the interesting thing about horror movies is that they often get a rap as being sort of like an amoral genre, just because there is this sort of element of schadenfreude to them. Mm-hmm. But the thing is that they're also kind of curiously moralistic, and I think in ways that can be sort of that can have really unfortunate implications. So basically the idea of and Cabin in the Woods gets at this with like the sort of the character system of horror, basically that it tends to punish people who it tends to punish youth, it tends to punish people for sexual promiscuity and mm-hmm. like and there's this sort of weird sort of puritanical strain that I think that kind of is hypocritical because it sort of revels in like sort of exploiting people's appetites for that while at the same time punishing that desire. So I think basically the sex equals death equation could probably be given a rest. There was a certain strain of horror that got popular in the aughts that was sort of dubbed as quote unquote torture porn, like the sort of the narratives, like stuff like Hostel and the Saw movies, of like basically of characters being sort of restrained and sort of, you know, eviscerated by somebody. That it's not a genre I'm particularly fond of, mainly because it's sort of I think the pleasure in horror is sort of the like the thrill of watching someone encounter things, but also like potentially awful things, but also the sort of identification with characters and wanting them to get out of these situations. And I feel like when you're put into a situation where you're forced to just watch people just endure this stuff, there's no character arc, there's no real narrative arc to that. There's nowhere to go emotionally. It's just sort of this harrowing experience that's often really unpleasant and sort of often aligns your perspective with that of the person doing the torturing, which is, you know, not a fun identification.
Right. So, I do remember the story of the Midnight Meat Train during our class. That did make me queasy. Wasn't my favorite.
Yeah, I remember you mentioning that.
Yeah. It was
didn't you
night.
Like ride the same line as that the
oh yeah
that the
ride,
killer took
because he takes the A train and then he wakes up and then there's a bunch of murder cannibals all over the place. So it was very disconcerting on the way home that night. Yeah,
were those like
short stories? Well, I'm sorry, I ruined
short stories.
Your ride home.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So what do you think about the direction of horror films today?
I think horror films are going in a really interesting direction. Basically, independent horror has really taken off in the last 10 years or so, probably maybe a little longer. But, like, there's an independent film movement called Mumblecore, which tends to do stuff like very low-budget, character-driven movies like, you know, Noam Baumbach and whatnot. Mm-hmm. And there's a sort of a corresponding movement in horror right now that has been dubbed Mumble Gore.
Mm-hmm.
That basically tends to use tends to be lower budget. They tend to be released on streaming services rather than theatrically, and they tend to sort of favor practical effects over CGI. Mm-hmm. But there's this sort of real, like, visceral, like, quality to that stuff. Like, a lot of really sort of interesting things that are being done with those films that are possible because they're not within the studio system and they don't have to sort of cater to a mainstream multiplex audience or, like, to cater to expectations of what are the prevailing trends are. So, like, less reliance on formulas like, say, like, found footage film, which can be fine. Like, I've enjoyed a few. But basically, when you get to, like, you know, Paranormal Activity 6, sort of like, how much further can we go with that? So, like, and to give a few examples, I'm talking about stuff like Adam Wingard's film, Your Next or The Guest, although both of those are the absolute, but some of his earlier stuff, like A Horrible Way to Die, was, for instance, like, sort of screaming. There's a really cool movie called Spring, which is sort of, I tend to describe it as being sort of like before sunrise meets the thing. Like, it's about this guy who goes through Europe and he falls in love with a beautiful girl who happens to be a shape-shifting monster. And basically, they do spend a lot of time walking around the city and talking. It's a fun movie.
So, Professor...
I like the topic is, yeah.
To wrap things up, I just wanted to ask about how people have some objections to horror films, because, you know, there's a group of people that believe that it promotes violence and desensitizes people to real violence. So what do you think about this?
I don't think that... I mean, I think there are plenty of people who consume horror in whatever medium, that don't go out and do awful things. I mean, basically, you know, and for that matter, people have been doing violent things to one another for as long as, well, there have been people. I mean, and, well, frankly, before that, I mean, you know, there's a reason why Tennyson wrote the line, nature red, tooth and claw. Like, I mean, we're sort of hardwired for violence in that way. And there's sort of naturally, like, a fascination with it. So really, I think our interest in life in the genre and in media with violent content is more a reflection of these tendencies that exist in everyday life and our anxiety about, and a way of confronting that in a safe way that say doesn't involve harming people.
Okay, well, thank you so much for your time, Professor Shepherd.
Yes.
No problem. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for joining the show. So you heard it here, folks, how a PhD candidate talks about horror and, you know, understands horror films and horror cliches. So, thank you again, Professor. Back to you, Kat.
Thank you for listening to Harlem Beat. Tonight's reporters were Sally Abreu, Michael Sanchez. Our headliner was Yvette Andino. Podcast reporters were Paloma Torres, Danielle Sattar, and Yvette Andino. PSA reporters were Madison Hoyos, Laura Taveras, Jasmine Rosa, and Ashley Galstag. Our board operator and also music director was Kima Carwin, assisted by WHCR's production manager, Tina Dixon. The radio journalism class is taught by Professor Angela Harden. I'm your host, Katiuska Nunez. Have a good and very safe Halloween. Good night, Harlem.
Listening to